Awesome. Hi, everyone. So I'm Caitlin. I'm a rising senior. So I'm from Canada. So we call it fourth year, which has been a little bit weird. But I'm a rising senior at the University of Waterloo with a computer science major, but also an entrepreneurship and geography double minor. I've been the co-director for Hack the North for the last 2 years. And I've also founded a nonprofit organization in Canada that encourages and empowers young girls to pursue engineering. So in the last 3 years, we've run 300 workshops and actually have had 4,400 girls attend them. So I like to think I have some sort of diverse background, but I do want to make sure that if there's something that doesn't make sense to you, or if there's something that you disagree with, please come find me, call me out on it, question me about it. Part of the reason why diversity is such a hard problem to solve is because we don't keep ourselves accountable. So I really want to make sure that, you know, this is an open space, but because I only have 5 minutes, I'm kind of going to go through what I think is really important. So my talk is How Diversity Starts With You. And today I'm going to quickly go over why it's important to me and my hackathon, because it's really important to set your respective reasons. Like, don't just kind of follow a trend. And then I'm going to go through what you can do as an individual and then what your hackathon can do as an entity. So for context, a diverse organization is basically one that values the difference in people and recognizes that people with different backgrounds, skills, altitudes, experiences bring fresh ideas to the table. Organizers should be actually encouraging this environment because it makes their hackathons more relatable and approachable and broadens kind of the different people that you can draw in. So by drawing in like large wide views, we can kind of meet the ever-changing hacker community. So Hack the North's team is pretty like tech, I guess, heavy. We have 41% of our team is in engineering and 38% is in math. But what's really great is that we have 15% of our individuals, which is about 5 organizers in arts, 2 of them, 2% in business, and 2% in science. So we've actually hit every different faculty at the University of Waterloo, and we have that present on our, recruitment team and when we're organizing. So diversity and inclusion should be considered through all stages of event planning, and oftentimes I find as hackathons, we have the luxury to only consider it at the event. So when we want to make the event exclusive, and we do a great job at that with like hygienic items or meetups and things like that, but you're only addressing people already in the pipeline, and that's kind of the problem. So with this statement, I want to encourage making the appropriate considerations with every decision you make. And that's not, and this is like not only limited to things like team recruitment, event logistics, marketing, copy, day of, and much more. So the before the event, the during the event, and the after the event is really important to address. Because at the end of the day, diversity, inclusion, this only starts when you decide to prioritize it. But I'm really glad because I look around this room and I find like this should be the reflection of the tech industry. Like, this is what it should feel like to be at a hackathon. But unfortunately, like in the reality, and I think you have seen at a lot of your hackathons, that's not true. So sharing some stats is that, so white male who make up about 30% of the US population to make over 50% of the STEM workforce. And that basically means a large fraction of the population that is made up of minorities are being left out, or they're not joining the pipeline, or we're losing them somewhere. So by minorities, I obviously mean people of color, but also women, people with disabilities, and sexual and general minorities. Like, diversity is not a binary term. So it's really hard to oftentimes like make big assumptions or generalizations over that, and you always have to be careful. So now, I personally think that diversifying hackathons and the tech industry is like a social justice issue. I think it's only fair to give proper representation to every single person in tech because it's the right thing to do. But at this point, it's actually what's great is it's also the smart thing to do. So research reveals that being in a diverse work environment forces us to think more and make fewer assumptions. So for example, a study at the University of Ohio has shown that when we're in a group of similar looking people, we make the assumption that we're also all similar thinking people. So we are less likely to bring new ideas because we all already think we agree with one another. Another study from the Stanford showed that when we're presenting an argument to a group of socially diverse people, we're more likely to provide more concrete evidence, and we try harder to convince everyone else in the group that they're the same person. So that being said, socially diverse groups of people are better at solving problems because they have deeper discussions, they share more information, they have a wider variety of ideas, and they can look at a problem from different perspectives. This hypothesis was actually confirmed by McKinsey. These numbers were shared yesterday, where the study revealed that gender-diverse companies were likely to outperform non-gender companies by 15%, and ethnically diverse companies are 35% more likely to outperform. So that being said, those are the reasons why I think diversity is important, and it's really important to define why it's important to you. Because if you don't believe in it and you're just following someone else's passion, it's not going to be executed very well. So what I want to share now is something called privilege, and it's kind of like what you can do. So privilege is like the access to societal and economic benefits based on characteristics that you possess. So some of them are, most of the understood forms of privilege are ones that you don't get to choose for yourself, unfortunately. So things like parental, racial, gender, and physical privilege. But there are things that you do get to choose, things like religion, gender identity, and education. And I want to talk about how you can leverage that as an individual to not only help the hacker community, but also the tech industry. Let's kind of learn about something called privilege lending. One of the biggest questions I get from my male friends are like, what can I do? I know it's really intimidating. People really don't take you seriously because they don't think you know what it feels like. So I want to kind of share how to become an ally. So there are three types of privilege lending, and they include credibility, which means when you attach your name to a project being undertaken by someone without privilege. Access lending, which is when you give access to a position, a location, or an event. The last one is expertise lending, where you give the opportunity to recognize as experts. So think back how maybe when you first joined your hackathon that you weren't necessarily in a leadership position. Someone obviously endorsed you. They saw that you were performing very well, and they put their name on, they put kind of your bets. So Hack the North was founded by 10 guys. And the fact that I am in a leadership position and my co-director is also females shows like strides that we have like moved past that, and that we are making these like considerations. So it's really important that like this is kind of addressed in your like legacy planning with your team recruitment, even like in internships this applies. So next steps. I found that a lot of the workshops have been really great for context, but it's been really hard to extract what I can do to help. What can I do next? So I've kind of summarized what you can do or what you can immediately start implementing at your hackathons at a before, during, and after. First thing is before your hackathon, basically hire a diverse team. Recruitment should be the most important thing because your organizing team is what reflects your hackathon at the end of the day. If you hire the same people, you're going to have a very similar hackathon with kind of assumptions based on like what they identify as. The next one is set a goal. So rather that's maybe something like if you want more first timers, if you want more underrepresented groups, if you just want a more inclusive culture, figure out what you want as a hackathon and what you want to accomplish and keep yourself accountable of that. Another one is engaging your target audience. So figure out kind of who you want to track. Message them, maybe, you know, most of your universities will have these diverse groups, and then also see if you can get their endorsement. So you posting in their Facebook group is okay, fine, you're gonna get some exposure, but having the president of that club post on your behalf is significantly better and holds so much more meaning, right? So make those connections, get people to buy into your vision, maybe have them attend 1 year and see kind of the environment. So it's really important to make those connections. Again, lots of things that we've mentioned this weekend, provide hacking resources, create inclusive copies. So oftentimes a lot of people don't actually identify themselves as a hacker if it's the first time going to hackathon, right? And that ends up making them think that they're not good enough and kind of triggers the imposter syndrome. Another one is providing travel reimbursement and assistance. That's really great. And kind of having a quick response time. So that's all before your hackathon. Now, during, one thing is, and what MLH really does is display preferred pronouns, and I think that's really great on name tags. Another one is providing hygienic items in your swag bag and also in the washroom, just making them accessible. Organizing meetups for these underrepresented groups, so maybe high school hackers at your hackathon, or women hackers at your hackathon, hardware hackers, designers, etc. And then hosting a diverse group of judges and mentors, making sure that the people that are at your event can see that, you know, someone like them can also, you know, go. Can become, you know, a mentor or a judge, or that kind of level of status is really encouraging and motivating. Another one is just facilitating an X in tech panel. So people that, again, identify with your hackers are actually talking about how they were able to succeed in tech, accommodating for dietary restrictions, providing contact information for like concerns, opening activities and workshops to the public. This has been really good if you get backlash from your community. And then just encouraging learning and not competition. And then just the last thing is after the event, definitely take the opportunity to survey your attendees. So send out an incentivized survey, rather it's like a raffle or a draw, something that will kind of convince more people to fill it out. Another one is publish a transparency report. So a lot of hackathons in Canada actually do this, where they share their budget, where they share the allocation of where their money went, their target audience, where they, the number of applicants they received, and the division and things like that. And that's really great for people to understand and keep you accountable and see the progress. And then the last one is just make sure you debrief with your team. So run a lot of experiments during your event, and it's fine to fail as long as you learn from it. And then follow up and see, okay, what did we learn from that? And yeah, that's kind of my presentation. If you have any questions, come find me.